Let us start by looking at the Poisson point process part of the posterior, which has an intensity function, which is simply 1 minus PD times the predicted PhD. Plugging in the expression for the predicted PhD, we note that this is a Gaussian mixture where the weights have been scaled by 1 minus PD. As I mentioned above, this Poisson point process represents all objects that are undetected at time k. In the algorithm that we are about to describe, we store the components which come from the Poisson point process as the first hk given k minus 1 components of the Gaussian mixture PhD. That is, in the first part of the Gaussian mixture PhD update, we run a for loop over h from 1 to the number of predicted components, and for each component, we set the updated weight to 1 minus PD times the predicted weight, whereas the updated mean and covariance are identical to the predicted mean and covariance. Apart from the Poisson point process, the posterior also contains mk Bernoulli components. These represent the detected objects at time k, and we obtain one potential object for each measurement, and there may be up to mk detected objects. The PhD of Bernoulli component number I is Ri times Pi, which is therefore its contribution to the posterior PhD. It turns out that we can write this product as a Gaussian mixture, where we sum over h from 1 to capital hk given k minus 1, over a weight that depends on both I and h, and a Gaussian density whose mean and covariance also depends on both I and h. The reason that we obtain a mixture for every measurement is of course that the predicted PhD is itself a mixture. Though I'm not going to cover all the details here, the Gaussian density is proportional to the measurement likelihood for measurement I times the Gaussian density for component h in the predicted PhD. A consequence of this is that we can obtain the moments of the Gaussian density with index I and h by performing a Kalman filter update of the predicted density number h using measurement number I. From this, you may get the impression that we need to perform one Kalman filter update for every value of I and h. However, since the matrices hk and rk are the same for all measurements zki, the predicted measurement distribution and the Kalman gain are the same for all values of I, even though they do depend on h, since h changes the predicted distribution. In the second part of the update step of the Gaussian mixture PhD filter, we compute the predicted measurement distribution, the Kalman gain, and the posterior covariance for all the different values of h. We do this in order to leverage on the fact that some of the Kalman filter parameters are identical for all values of I. In the algorithm, we loop over h from 1 to capital H, k given k minus 1, and compute the predicted measurement z hat h, the predicted measurement covariance, sh, the Kalman gain, kh, and the posterior covariance, ph. All of these are computed in a standard Kalman filter update. Note that all of these depend on h, since they depend on mu h and ph k given k minus 1. We are now ready to perform part 3 of the Gaussian mixture PhD update, which is where we compute and store all the components that correspond to all the different Bernoulli components. To do this, we use an outer for loop over I from 1 to mk. That is, here we loop over all the measurements, or the Bernoulli components. For every measurement, we would like to compute the moments mu and p, as well as a weight, for every value of h, and store them with a suitable index. In this algorithm, we store the variables using the index I times capital H k given k minus 1 plus h. For instance, if h and I are both 1, we use the index capital hk given k minus 1 plus 1. This makes sense, since we already used the first indices to store the parameters corresponding to the Poisson point process part of the posterior. For every h, we compute mu using a Kalman filter update, and the parameters computed in part 2 of the algorithm. Obtaining the corresponding value of the covariance p is even simpler, since that covariance is the same for all values of I, and was already computed in part 2. Finally, obtaining the weights is a bit more complicated, and we first compute a temporary variable, w tilde, which is pd times wh times the predicted likelihood of zki, assuming the predicted distribution number h. After completing one for loop, we run another for loop to store the weights, where we first divide the weights, w tilde, by a constant. We note that this part ensures that the sum over the weights for a single Bernoulli component can never be larger than 1, which makes sense since the expected number of objects from a Bernoulli random finite set is at most 1. As for the last part of this algorithm, the denominator does not actually depend on h and can be pre-computed before starting the for loop. Let us visualize the update step in an example which is a continuation of the toy example that we used to visualize the prediction step. This means that the predicted PhD is a Gaussian mixture with 4 components. As illustrated in the figure, we assume that we observe the measurements minus 1, 0, and 1 at time k. Suppose the probability of detection is 0.7. This means that the Poisson point process, representing the set of objects that are undetected at time k, is 1 minus PD, or 0.3, times the predicted PhD. Also, suppose that the measurement model is such that HK is 1, and that the standard deviation of the measurement noise is 0.2. Finally, we assume that the clutter intensity is 0.3 in the interval minus 5 to 5. Due to the 3 measurements, we obtain a multi-Bernoulli with 3 Bernoulli components, where 2 of them have spatial PDFs around minus 1 and 1, whereas the 3rd Bernoulli has a bimodal spatial PDF close to 0. We have illustrated the PhD of that multi-Bernoulli process using an orange curve in the figure. We obtain the posterior PhD by adding the contributions from the undetected and detected objects, which gives us the dash-dotted red curve in the figure. As you can see, the posterior PhD is dominated by 2 peaks around minus 1 and 1, which are due to the corresponding measurements. However, we also see that we have smaller peaks around minus 2 and 2, corresponding to potential objects that are undetected. When considering the posterior PhD, I encourage you to recall its interpretation as the expected number of objects per unit, and that we approximate the posterior as a Poisson point process with this intensity function. To conclude, we have seen that the Gaussian mixture PhD update is very simple. The computations mostly consist of a number of different Kalman filter updates, and the slightly more expensive parts, where we compute the Kalman gain and the posterior covariance, are only performed one time for every term in the predicted PhD. The number of terms in the posterior PhD grows as mk plus 1 times the number of terms in the predicted PhD. Note that this is true regardless of how many objects we think are present, which makes it a remarkably efficient multi-object tracking algorithm. For comparison, you may recall the function na that Carl introduced to denote the number of possible associations between m measurements and n objects. As we increase m and n, na grows very quickly. However, the factor mk plus 1 that appears in the PhD filter is identical to na for mk measurements and 1 object, which is potentially several orders of magnitude smaller than, say, na of mk, and our current guess of the number of objects, n hat k given k.